high enthusiastic book fans, author supporters, and cultural supporters. I'm sure we're going to have people coming because that's how Jackson rolls, right? But welcome to Jackson Community Church. My name is Gail. I'm a minister here. And we're really excited that Janice is reading for us tonight. And I'm a newbie in the writing group that Janice has been a long time member of.
And Julie.
And so, yes, and Rocky. And there's a bunch of you that are all members. So I'm the newbie. So you guys probably know Janice better than I do. And with that, please.
Really? My time.
It's your time.
Thank you. Listen, thank you all for coming out tonight. I know once I get in for the evening, I don't want to come back out, so I really appreciate it. I'd like to stay inside. And a heartfelt thanks to Gail for offering Jackson Community Church as a venue for this. What I went through to write this book really changed my life. It was a four-year journey just to get it published. Okay, so next time you look at a book in a book story, it didn't just get there by magic. There's a long story behind it. In real time, the story covers a span of roughly 10 years. And I'm going to read some, what I think are key sections, and then yield the floor for conversation or commentary or whatever that we can have. We can have what I call polite conversation about any possible thing. So I'm going to start with chapter one, and we'll take it from there.
Can you hold the book up so you can see it? That's a second beautiful copy.
Show and tell. Everybody see it?
And then tell us the name of it, Jim.
I'm sorry?
Tell us the name of it.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, the book is called White Roses, A Memoir, Holding the Impossible, A Love Story Before and After Death. So the short version is White Roses, A Memoir. And it is most easily available on Amazon.com. And hopefully, eventually, it'll be in Barnes and Nobles, but I don't feel safe telling anybody that right now. So go to Amazon and get your copy. Chapter 1, May 5th, 2013. For the Man with the Wonderful Hair. What happened to me on May 5th, 2013, and the subsequent experiences didn't come out of nowhere. Being genetically predisposed to see the dead, I was the fourth generation to have this and related abilities. According to family lore, it started with my maternal great-grandfather, my grandmother's father, and trickled down. My ability to do this was verified at the age of three. I woke up one early winter morning and saw my Uncle George seated on the foot of my bed, glowing in this soft yellow light. We had a conversation that didn't become clear for decades until I was ready to hear it. Uncle George had died from tuberculosis long before I was born, when he was 21. I remember running into the kitchen and telling my grandparents while struggling to climb and seat myself in a kitchen chair, "Mama, Mama, I just saw Uncle George. He was sitting on my bed." This was just another piece of information as far as my grandparents were concerned. They weren't shocked or alarmed. There were no admonishments, no denial. It was just information, like the weather, the time of the day, or the day of the week. My grandmother said something like, "You did? Okay." She continued fixing breakfast while my grandfather nodded his head in acknowledgement. Neither one of them said I was crazy nor making it up. The second experience happened roughly 2 years later when I was five. There was a fire on the narrow street behind our house. Such commotion from the perspective of a five-year-old was overwhelming. There were fire trucks, sirens, people screaming. My grandfather and I stood at the kitchen door and watched one of the houses burn down to its foundation. I looked up at the night sky right over the house and saw three figures, two adults and a child rising up. Papa, Papa, look, I said, pointing to the sky. Are those people going to heaven? I hope so, Pumpkin, I hope so. The next day in the newspaper, there was a story about the fire. Three people had died, two adults and a child. My grandparents who raised me understood that their only grandchild would straddle the world of spirit and the Western world grounded in science and or fact. One of the first questions I remember asking my grandfather had to do with God, the creator, the great mystery. Understanding and knowing God or the great mystery was important to me even as a child. I spent time pondering what many couldn't see or feel. No one knew this except my grandparents. I was seeing that other world through the veil often and developing an array of different ways of knowing. After May 5th, 2013, I spent a lot of time recalling things I had heard from my grandparents, my grandmother, my great aunts, and general gossip among my grandparents' friends about people like me. People who had this different way of knowing, who heard things no one else around them heard, and saw what they described as, quote, beyond the veil. Until now, this is my little secret. On May 5th, 2013, I was forced to pay attention and driven to understand what this was all about since it presented itself in such a dramatic fashion. The definition of who I am was incomplete. I had to face the fact that although I was a quiet person, I wasn't living a quiet life. Imagine being able to sense a person's true intent, to read between the lines and see beyond the mask we all wear as we go about our daily lives. I walk into a room full of people and often get all kinds of information about the nature of what struggles people were going through. It's worse than seeing them naked. Sometimes it's like looking at the landscape of their soul. Too often in my personal life, and occasionally in my professional life, I ignored or dismissed information received this way and paid for it. My grandfather, Papa, died in 1980. Mama died in 1989. I went home to Gulfport for the funeral. Walking into the living room, the power of my grandparents' presence stopped me, and I said out loud, oh my God, they're here. Experiencing their presence felt like running into an invisible force field. That night, sleeping in my childhood bedroom, I felt the edge of the bed sink. Turning over, I saw my grandmother sitting there while my grandfather sat in a nearby chair smoking his pipe. The comfort was enormous. The gratitude for being able to see them was beyond articulation. Since their transition, my experiences and different ways of knowing expanded. They became subtle but powerful companions, advising and protecting me, professionally and personally, in unexpected ways. I could never put this on a resume, however. Now, roughly 35 years after their deaths, I knew my grandparents had prepared me for what happened on the morning of May 5th, 2013. Looking at that panoramic view of Mount Washington from the living room, I felt two hands on my shoulders and then heard a voice I recognized. Tell our story. Tell what was and what was meant to be. Do what I read you could do and finish it by the end of May. It was the voice of the man I knew I was going to marry, Tony Carter. He died in 2007. On May 28, 2013, 23 days later, the first draft of what you're about to read was finished. I still don't know why he wanted me to finish it by the end of the month, unless he considered May his month. He was born in May. I ended up writing most of White Roses in the middle of the night, between 11 p.m. and 2:30 a.m. in my bedroom. There were no distractions then. 3 or 4 days into writing that draft, a small image of a well-known actor appeared in the corner of my bedroom. He plays the lead role in a popular television series. I remember laughing and thinking I'd been watching way too much television. Within days, that image filled the entire room. I stopped writing. Something was up. This was not my imagination. I looked at the image of the actor. He did not look like Tony. Leaning back in bed, I heard Tony's voice. This is my emissary. He will help you through some difficult times while writing this. You'll find me in his eyes. There's a teacher coming to help also. She has a comical connection to the emissary. And then Tony was gone. I didn't understand the connection, but I knew enough to know something was up. At that moment, I didn't realize I had already made an unconscious connection with the emissary. I started researching the emissary. Social media can be a wonderful resource. I looked at every photo I could find and discovered three shots that made me stop breathing. The shock of the energy coming through the emissary's eyes was the exact spirit of Tony. Both had a distinctive physicality. Both were at ease with their bodies. They shared a fondness for the same color and went to the same college, but each for only 2 years under entirely different circumstances. They shared a passion for issues, activism, and politics, and came from complicated families. There were other similarities they shared, but I knew I was still missing something. I found the emissary's biography, and there it was in the very last line. They shared the same birthday. The emissary did get me through some difficult times while writing this in very unexpected, amusing, comforting ways. I found the teacher just a few miles from where I lived, and yes, she had a comical connection to him. At least it made me laugh by her. Revealing all of this is hard because I am a very private person. But the need to start having intelligent conversations about impossible things transcends my comfort. Chapter 2. Now we get into the end anyway. Who is this man? Spring 2005. Like most days when I was in New York City and not at my country place in the Hudson River Valley, the end of the day was signified by walking my American Cocker Spaniel with Spike in Yokohama around 5:30 or 6 p.m. I adored them. I stood at the corner and watched cars fly down West End Avenue. I noticed the days were getting longer, the air a little warmer. The light changed and we walked down to the street. The light changed and we walked down to the street to Riverside. As I turned the corner, I saw my close friend Christine slowly walking towards her building. She saw me and waved. I waved back and caught up with her. She was holding a tote bag with books packed into the straining point. I could see the leather seams beginning to give. Christine was a big woman, not heavy or fat, just big bone, tall and formal looking. She had flawless brown skin and jet black hair, tightly braided into an intricate pattern. She was brilliant, a college professor who taught contemporary political science at Columbia University. Two children and a husband, who was an attorney, filled out her domestic profile. "Hey," Christine said, "what's going on?" And she sat the tote down on the sidewalk. "Listen," I said, "I've been meaning to ask you something." Christine patted Yoko and Spike. Standing up, she looked at me and said, "Ask away." I pointed to a metallic navy blue late model BMW parked across from her building. "Do you know who owns this BMW?" "How would I know?" Christine managed to frown and smile at the same time. "Well, he probably lives somewhere, right here, maybe in your building. How many people could there be? I've seen him for years drive a series of BMWs. You know, I love those cars. Remember how I drove one for 10 years? Christine stared at me. "Yeah, I remember. He drove it into the ground. Let me get this straight. You want me to go looking for a strange man in New York City who might be living where? In my building? He's not strange. He's right here somewhere. You do know him. I know that." Okay. What is this? A gut feeling on your part? Your gut feelings can scare the hell out of me sometimes. Stop. Just go look for him," I urged. "Well, why can't you find out?" Christine asked me. "You're not doing that. Come on. Seeking out information about some man for no other reason than curiosity was somehow beneath me. I'm not going to do it," I repeated. "But I can do that. I can go snooping around. What am I supposed to do? Stake out the car?" Christine asked. "If need be," I said. Christine groaned and sighed. "Okay. So what does he look like?" "Details, girl. Details. You're an artist." "Great," I thought. "She's going to do it." "Okay. Well, he's got wonderful hair. I like the way it's graying. There's something very appealing about it. And I guess he's about 6 feet, maybe a little taller, and lean, thick, very fit." "So you're telling me he's not fat?" "No fat man in my life," I said. "I felt badly about saying that, but not that badly." Okay, I'll see what I can find out. You owe me for this, Christine said, and picked up her tote bag. I responded with, only if you find out who he is. Too much, let's go. We continued to walk. I was quietly thrilled with the prospect of getting some information on this man. I've been curious for a long time. Chapter 3, The Man with the Wonderful Hair. My days ended with walking Spike and Yoko, and they began with walking them also. The next morning, I stumbled out of bed and managed to get us all out by 7 a.m. or so. The spaniels pulling me across the street, I heard, I've been watching you for over 20 years. You don't change, the dogs don't change. I thought I was hallucinating, but I heard it again and turned around. Thankfully, I was wearing sunglasses. I could feel my eyes widen. I was stunned. It was him, the man with the wonderful hair. A wave of joy washed over me. For a minute, I couldn't find my voice. Holding several newspapers, he walked by me with a smile. I think he had on a pair of navy blue Bermuda shorts, a light blue t-shirt, a baseball cap, and some brown boating shoes. He was attractive in a very masculine way. I realized I had to say something before he walked away. Wait a minute, who are you? What's your name? Still smiling, he looked at me and said, Tony, and kept walking. He walked down to Riverside Drive, turned the corner, and disappeared. I was immobile with shock when I realized the spaniels and I were still standing in the intersection. I stepped up on the sidewalk and knew I had to come up with ways to bump into him again. As I walked with the spaniels down to the park, something made me realize that I had just flipped a switch, and it made me nervous and giddy. I would never admit that yet. Spike and Yoko stopped to sniff some bushes, and two thoughts collided in my head. He's been watching me for 20 years? Well, what is that? And where has he been watching me from? And that's how it started. And there were a series of extraordinary encounters, coincidences that threw us together. That's all there was to it. And that's all I knew. Hopefully you'll read it when you find the book. So I'm going to pick it up from the last day of his life. It was a little past 6 p.m. Summer had officially arrived a few days earlier, but the weather delivered the heat long before. Common sense forced me to put on a pair of denim shorts, t-shirt, and sandals. As usual, my hair felt out of control, but it wasn't. I had it radically cut for manageability. My beautician wanted me to consider dyeing my hair color the silver and white hairs that were taking over, obliterating the jet black masses of curls. I said no. There were too many people who considered it my trademark. Even Tony had commented, thinking it was a ruse so people would get confused about my age. The truth was, I was too lazy and too cheap to spend hundreds of dollars every month on my hair. Anyway, I liked confusing people. As we turned the corner, someone ran by me and briefly slipped their arm around my waist. It was a very smooth move, and for a second or two, all of us were jogging along until he let go of my waist. It was Tony. Well, I said, where are you going? Slow down. He turned to face me and continued to run backwards, as if he were playing basketball, but at a slower pace. I'm late. I've got to take these people out. Out where? What people? I've never seen them this rush. At the same time, I remembered him playing basketball several weeks ago. I saw him walking down the street one day, bouncing a basketball, and noticed a band-aid over his left eyebrow. Alarmed, I pointed to it. He said, basketball. Okay, I replied. I never thought of basketball as a violent sport, but it could get rough. In unison, he said, fighting off old age. Come back to the present, I heard him say, my boat, every year I take out some people for work. Remember I told you that last night. Was it possible to be jealous of a boat? I pushed that out of my mind. It made me feel childish. It's just a boat. And then I remembered when he told me and how he told me. It was a miracle. I finally got him to stop for more than 5 minutes. By now he had reached his car. He stopped for a minute and looked at me. When I come back, we're going out, he said. Dinner, brunch, whatever you want. We have a lot to talk about, right? He looked at me me, and I looked at him as he gazed at me before starting his car. We had some intense conversations with our eyes. I had never experienced anything like that with anyone else. I felt my face light up at the prospect of really talking with this man as he drove away. I looked down at Spike and Yoko and said, "Did you hear that? We're going out. We're going to talk like grown-ups. Finally." As he drove away, I felt a brief sense of frustrated victory. I almost skipped home, singing in my head and bringing joy. I didn't care if he was seeing anybody else, because as of yesterday, when we had our encounter, our conversation, those women were now toast, cooked, done, gone. Wait until I tell Kate, I thought. As soon as I fed Spike and Yoko, I combed through my CDs and pulled out the original version of "You're All I Need to Get By." It made me smile. I kept saying to myself, yes, yes, yes. I found the Alicia Keys recording that was haunting Tony and me. Everything's going to be all right. It is now, I believe, because Tony said, when he comes back, we're going out. I said that out loud to Spike and Yoko, and Yoko barked back at me. I was an opera fan, but there were some arias that really moved me, and one of those was "Tanti Papiro," the loose translation being "The Time to Say Goodbye." For me, music was one of the most magical arts. I put all three on the CD player, leaned back on the couch to enjoy the new possibilities between Anthony, Jacob, Ian, Carter, III, and myself, Spike, and Yoko. The evening slowly unfolded. The air was still thick with heat and humidity, but a wave of cold washed over me suddenly. As quickly as it came, it left. Maybe 5 minutes later, it happened again. My first thought was I was coming down with annoying summer cold. I got up from the couch and went to fix a cup of tea. As soon as I was in the kitchen, the spaniel started to bark. I rushed back to the living room and found them barking at the Eames lounge chair. I looked at the chair and then at them, motioning for quiet. They stopped barking but continued staring at the chair. Spike began to circle the chair and wagged his tail. Yoga had jumped up on the couch and watched the chair, smiling, mouth open, a tongue hanging halfway out. I didn't like it, and I ignored what I sensed. I walked back to the kitchen and experienced another chill. What is going on? I asked myself. I went to bed thinking about all the possibilities that waited for Tony and me, the places we would go, the things we would see, the fun that set poised when Christmas came to Fifth Avenue, the red bow around the Cartier's building, Rockefeller Center, the magical store windows. I wondered if he had ever been to Paris. I knew I was getting ahead of myself, but I didn't care. Evening became night. Spike and Yoko were in bed next to me, cuddled up, ready for sleep. I turned out the light, it still felt cold. I pulled up a lightweight comforter and refused to think about why I was feeling cold. Just as I drifted off to sleep, I heard the spaniels bark once or twice. I felt them move to the foot of the bed, and I sensed the presence of someone else. The next morning, after walking Spike and Yoko, I sat down at my desk and went online to check my emails. It was later than usual for me, close to 9:30 a.m. I knew I had missed Tony. He was already at work. I would email him and find out how the boat ride went and remind him that we were going out. The only noise I heard while scanning my emails came from the spaniels. Excuse me. For some reason, they were restless. I could hear them moving around in the living room. I saw an email from Christine. I leaned back in my chair, clicked it open, and my light blew up. "Hey, Janice, I'm going away for a few days, but I just thought you should know in case you haven't heard. Tony died yesterday in a boating accident. He drowned. It was on the news last night. I'll call you this evening." I read that over and over. Time froze. Everything was not a blur. It was all too clear. I was barely breathing. I felt disemboweled, gutted like a fish. I was now face to face with a threatening intruder. It was grief, armed and dangerous. A different kind of devastation as a sidekick. I was lost. I was enraged. I want somebody to pay for this. shall have my vengeance in this life or the next. Somebody, somewhere had to be responsible. Everything in my head and heart broke. I sat there and said, no, 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 this can't be. There's got to be a mistake. I must have said that, no, 100 times. I had to call somebody. Somebody had to know something. I started to think about who could possibly have some information. Do I still know anyone in the newsroom of the affiliate stations where I used to work? How do I reach a sister? Where is she? How could Tony drown? That just doesn't make any sense. He couldn't drown. He was still at home in the water. How does that happen? It's got to be wrong. But I knew it wasn't. The Spaniels were now barking. I got up and almost fell, running to them. They were standing on the ottoman, barking and wagging their tails at the empty King's lounge chair. I waited for them for a few minutes, and then walked over to calm them. What's the matter? What are you barking at? Come on, let's go to the kitchen and get some biscuits. They understood biscuits and stopped barking. They followed me into the kitchen. My head was spinning. After they ate, they went right back to the lounge chair, still unsettled. I took a deep breath to calm myself, fixed a cup of tea, and went back to my office. I called Lucinda and told her the news. Lucinda was my housekeeper. What do you mean he's dead? Dead how? I told her what I knew, and she shrieked, a boat! What the hell are you doing with a boat? He on a boat? Oh my God! I'd be right down, Miss Alice. You should not be by yourself. I didn't think it was necessary for her to come down, but she ignored it, thank God. Kay was my next call. It was a part of me that was dreading this. So that's how his life ended. And shortly after that, things started happening. So this is from chapter 10, called That Big Church. I didn't know when I did this, nor how, considering I was in a daze. But I wrote a note to Kathy, his sister, the day after Tony died. I didn't know how to introduce myself. I didn't know what she knew. I figured she knew something, because Tony confided in her, but how much? Did she know about that encounter? Had he talked to her about me before asking me out? Maybe the woman hated me, but I would risk finding that out. I wanted his sister to know in some small way that I understood the totality of this very specific grief that tears open your heart and leaves you bloodless, stunned, mute, and a little crazy. Nothing would ever be the same, but you'd be flooded with well-meaning cliches and cards and conversations. Time heals all wounds. You'll get through this. With time, your grief will diminish. I knew these were lies. This grief doesn't diminish. It simply changes. It may feel differently. Occupy until now unknown spaces in your heart, your soul, and memory. This grief pops up and screams your loss at inconvenient times and in peculiar ways. Usually when you're surrounded by the wrong people. This grief can wrap itself around you like a boa constrictor and render you immobile for a few minutes or a few days, sometimes forever. But it doesn't go away, and you won't forget, and you will never stop hurting. It will just be different. And when well-meaning, sincere friends say, let me know if there's anything I can do, ask them, can you bring him back? The service began. All my abandoned Episcopalian ways came back. I was fine until the casket was rolled in. At times, I thought I could see right through it to Tony's body, lying there immobile, eternally still, probably wearing something blue. I thought my brain would explode. I closed my eyes to hold back the tears and stop myself from letting out a shattering, impolite, non-Episcopalian scream. I heard the priest say, Tony, you left us too soon. I didn't didn't know what to do except be thankful he'd been in my life at all. When I stood for a prayer, I heard Tony whisper in my ear, "I'm never going to leave you. I'm here for you." He was standing right next to me, and it took my breath away. "This is our church," he said. I could feel his closeness, and I could feel him smile. He touched my hand, and I opened mine so he could wrap his hand around mine. For a second, I saw him. A wash of emotion filled my entire being. I was flooded with relief that he wasn't really gone. His presence had a distinctive vibration that I sensed. Even though I saw him for only a second, I felt his hand in mine, and that was all I needed. I also felt slightly dizzy. There was a buzzing and humming sensation I had ignored. I wanted to dance out of the church. Right then, I decided to come back to this church, because at the very least, I could find Tony's spirit there. But someone was staring at me, and I turned to see who it was. An older, distinguished woman with beautiful white hair, pulled back in a bun, was looking at me with a deep, warm expression. At that instant, I knew that she knew. I knew that somehow she was also seeing Tony. The warmth of Tony's hand began to fade, and I noticed that the church was empty. Time had stopped for me. The service was over, and the woman was gone. I looked for her. It seemed like she too had vanished. So, more spooky things begin to happen now. I am going to go to the part where the first vision occurred, which was when I was working at a radio station. When I returned to my office, the station manager reminded me of the staff outing the next day, our annual bonding event. I didn't pay close attention to what he was saying because I had no interest in it. The fact that it was the next day never stayed in my mind. The next day came, and promptly at noon, the station manager marched into my office and said, "Let's go, it's time." Flexed, I looked up at him and said, "Go where?" "The staff outing. Come on, let's go," he said, and walked out. I found some of my colleagues at the elevator and asked one of them, "Where are we going?" "He's chartered a boat for us. We'll circle Manhattan like tourists, have some lunch, a drink or two, get back, and go home early. Let the computers run the station." "We're going for a boat ride," I repeated. "Yeah, what's wrong?" My stomach sank. I was terrified of getting on boats. You were never flush with the dock leaving a couple of inches where you could see the water. And I was convinced I was going to fall through that space and drown. All boats were now condemned as far as I was concerned. It was a damn boat that took Tony away from me. We stood on the dock making small talk while waiting for the boat to come. The operations manager walked over and asked, "Are you okay? You look funny." I liked her. She had a great sense of humor. And we both had a deep appreciation for shoes. That's my phone. I studied her for a few seconds before saying anything. "You know, I lost someone to a boat accident almost a year ago. I'm not big on boats. Why didn't you tell me? I would have found a way for you to get out of this. No, it's okay. I'll survive." People started getting in line. Slowly, I walked towards the boat, looking down, and saw the approaching gap. "Oh, Jesus," I thought, "how am I going to do this?" The last time I was in a predicament like this was leaving the command station at the Panama Canal while covering a presidential campaign. Those huge gates would open and close, allowing boats to slip through. Who knew that when the gates closed to form a narrow footbridge, they weren't flush in the middle? There had to be almost a 6-inch gap. I survived with the help of the cameraman walking in front of me and the sound man walking in back of me. How was I going to survive this? The person in front of me got on the boat. It was my turn, and I could barely breathe, much less lift my feet. "Come on, don't worry. I won't let you fall." I was so startled by Tony's voice, I leapt on board. Everyone else went into the main cabin. I dropped into the first seat I could find on the deck. The boat pulled away and started pushing its way through the Hudson River, headed to the most northern part of Manhattan to veer east into the East River, going south. The air was warm, and I could feel the soft spray of water sprinkle my face. I took some deep breaths and started thinking about the absurdity of a tongue drowning. The operations manager came out of the cabin. She sat down next to me and asked, "Are you okay?" I looked out at the water for a moment before answering her. "I'm going to be fine. Just give me some time. I'll be in soon." "Okay, they haven't started serving lunch yet, but, you know, once they do..." I nodded my head and went back, and she went back to the cabin. Staring at the water, I dozed off. My head dropped and bounced back. I opened my eyes, looking up, and saw Tony sailing. He had on the most sparkling white polo shirt I've ever seen. It was dazzling, but not blinding. And he had on a pair of khaki cargo Bermuda shorts. He looked so happy. It was so vivid, so real. Within seconds, the image faded. I wanted to get off the boat, but I was stuck there for over an hour. So I am going to go forward to the last incident that happened of that series. The following Friday morning, I was leaving the city for the country and decided to visit Tony's grave on the way. The first anniversary of his death was approaching. I'd been avoiding this, but I needed to see where his family had put him. I needed to do something. Spaniels and I headed up to Putnam County, where the cemetery was located. Upon arriving, I received a map with the location of his graveside circled, a vague set of driving directions. The cemetery was small and beautifully landscaped, with narrow lanes requiring to drive slowly. I passed several small chapels before arriving at his gravesite. Lowering the car window, I left Spike and Yoko and walked over to Tony's headstone. Standing in front of it, I was aware of birds flying overhead. I looked over my shoulder just in time to see an owl fly by my car. As he went on his way, I said out loud, "You can try and talk to me. Didn't pay attention. I'm sorry." Someone had put fresh flowers on Tony's grave. I reached inside my pocket, pulled out a seashell, and placed it in front of the headstone. "I have to see where they put you," I said. I couldn't come after the service. I sat cross-legged on his grave for what felt like a half hour and stared at the headstone, grateful that he had come into my life and devastated he left so soon. I told him, when he finally spoke to me, I knew my life was never going to be the same. There was something joyful and playful in your eyes, and I knew. And that way women know that if you and I would spend our lives together. My heart was open, my hands were open. I was ready to welcome you into my life. Sitting there, I lost track of time. When I looked at my watch, I saw that over an hour had passed. I got up, wiped away some tears, pulled out a tissue from my pocket, and blew my nose. I walked back to my car. I wanted to get to the country before it was dark. I saw Spike and Yoko looking just beyond me, and I felt a presence behind me. When I looked over my shoulder, I saw a stream of golden flecks following me. I was awestruck. There was a beauty about these flecks that brought a smile to my face. They seemed to be alive and went with me into the car and filled it. The Spaniels were enchanted. I had no idea what anyone else saw. Frankly, I was scared to look at drivers passing by. The car held those flecks all the way to the house and inside to the living room. I collapsed on the living room couch, leaned back, and watched these golden flecks fill the room. It was magical and amazing. They seemed to have individual lives as they danced and twinkled. At one point, I thought these flecks were breathing. They were alive in a way I didn't understand. Sometimes they clustered, wrapping me in their light. Spike and Yoko stood in the middle of the floor trying to catch them. When they realized it was futile, they jumped up on the couch next to me. was a hypnotic quality to these flecks. One by one, they gradually disappeared. I heard myself say, "Wow." I looked at the spaniels and said, "I've got to call Kathy. She has to know about this, all of it." I had her work number and her home address written down somewhere. It took me a few minutes to locate it. I called her at work and reintroduced myself. She said, "Oh, I know who you are." I didn't know if that was a good thing or a bad thing. "Listen, I've got to talk to you. I know this sounds crazy, but I've really got to talk to you. I can come to you, or if you like, I'd be happy to have you come to my place in the city. I'll be back in a few days." "Okay," she said, "I know where you live." I was taken aback by her response. How did she know where I lived? I assumed Tony told her. We confirmed the date and time. Kathy would come next week. At the exact time and place, Kathy showed up at the apartment and received an enthusiastic greeting from the spaniels. They calmed down and trotted into the living room with Kathy behind them. She looked around and commented on all my books. "You know, Tony would love this, all these books." I smiled and asked if I could get her some tea or wine, anything. She said no and sat down. I know this is going to sound crazy, and I'm not sure why I have to tell you this, but I do. "Okay," she said, and moved back in one of the living room chairs. I recounted the first vision I had on the staff album that showed me Tony Salen dressed in a dazzling white polo shirt, tan card over knee shorts. Kathy started to cry, and I was stricken. I started to apologize. Kathy wiped her eyes and said, no, you don't understand. There's nothing wrong." Before I closed the casket, I had rolled up his favorite sailing outfit and put it in there. It was a white polo shirt and a pair of tan cargo shorts. I told him when he got to the other side, he would have his favorite sailing outfit, and he does. I was unable to move for a few seconds. I didn't know what I was feeling, but I continued and told Kathy about seeing Tony with a baby girl and described her in as much detail as I could. "Oh my God, you couldn't possibly know this, but that was our little sister. She was barely a year old when she died. Tony was heartbroken. I'm not sure he ever got over it. He never talked about her again. Now I know he's with her." I leaned back and felt the couch reach for my back. "Kathy, I didn't know." "No, of course not," she said. "Well, I have just one more incident to tell you about." I told her about visiting Tony's grave and the golden flecks that followed us home. Kathy took out a tissue from her handbag, dried her eyes, and smiled. She looked at me and said, "Okay, now I have a story for you. One of our cousins had a baby some time ago. Tony and I went to visit her and see the baby. Tony held the baby. His eyes were full of tears. Anyway, our cousin wasn't able to come to the funeral, but maybe a week or so after, she called me one morning. She told me that every morning since the funeral, she'd wake up, look in the mirror, and see little golden flecks on her face. Even when she washed her face, they wouldn't go away. Within an hour or so, they disappeared on their own. She concluded it was Tony washing over her." Kathy paused and looked at me and said, "Janice, I think he's watching over you too. So I'm going to stop there."
Questions?
And has made his presence known, which I go into in the book. No, he's still here. For me, he's still here. I don't know what's happened to him, or anybody else in his family, but for me, he's still here. And that has been comforting and frustrating. But yes, the grief changes. The grief changes. I still grieve over the fact that he is not in this realm. And seriously, it is rarely a day that goes by when I don't ask, why did you have to leave now? And he told me, and that's in the book, he told me why he had to leave. And I still wasn't happy with it. I got a response. Oh, come on, I know there's some questions out there. Look, I used to teach school, but let me go around the room. I know how to do this. I could make comments, but... one thing that I don't know that is in your book, but I think is interesting, just talking about the fact that you have these abilities. Maybe talk a little bit to when you were born.
Yeah. Okay, fine.
Some children are born with what my family would call a veil over their face. And what that means is simply that there's embryonic fluid is wrapped around their face and sometimes around their entire body. Approximately one in every 800,000 children are born this way. Not every one of those children has the ability to see beyond the veil, but the overwhelming majority of those that do, according to the research I found out, have these abilities. So I was born with a veil over my face, and that's when I started at the very beginning that it was confirmed when I saw my uncle seated on the edge of the bed. And, you know, like I said, you can't put that in a resume. I'm going to send you away. But yeah, it's a very distinctive look. You can't mistake it for anything else. It's not Colton Crane, it's like, oh my God.
It's also called a call.
Yes, it's called a call, C-A-U-L. And in the back of the book there is a reference list for people to go to if they have questions or they're curious about all these things that hopefully will help shed some light on this phenomenon. But yeah. And those children who are born that way in certain communities are often honored and are often terrified of people, other people who are terrified. Because, you know, you can see stuff that they can't see, and that terrifies.
They burn in the cell.
Now, those were witches. Let's be clear.
There's a distinct
difference. Yes, ma'am.
Janice, so you've had a calling to write this book.
Yes.
And now that it's at the point it's at,
mm-hmm.
Have you felt yet the lifting of something or a relief, or have you not? It's been new that you've gotten to this point, mm-hmm. but has it been a shift in what you're feeling?
Yeah, you know, somebody asked me that yesterday, mm-hmm. and the honest answer is no. Mm-hmm. I wrote this because of the compelling way in which it was requested, and you know, that was enough to get me started, and when I did finish it, I started to think about, well, okay, you've done this, that's nice, now what? You know, what does success look like to you? And for me, not for anybody else, success will be when I finally meet the emissary, that there is some reason that he has to know about this. So for me, that's how the circle will be completed. And look, I want all y'all to buy the book. Don't misunderstand me. Don't buy many copies. Other things to do, buy the book. And that will make me very happy. And it will make my agent very happy and the publisher very happy. And that's sort of the traditional measurement of success. But for me, the personal measurement is this, connecting with this guy.
So I think that maybe that's something he might have anticipated, that yet another step.
Yeah. And it didn't come to me as I was writing it. I mean, I think in the process of writing it, I had answered lots of questions. Uh-huh. And one of the questions that sort of tantalizes many people I talked to was, why did he wait 20 years?
Right.
Guy watching you from somewhere for 20 years, I asked myself, what is wrong with you? And I remember sitting in my bed, you know, and I'm sort of thinking, what were you doing? 20 years, you realize you got a life, you could have done this, da-da-da-da-da, and I heard, I was afraid you would ignore me. Anyway, that is the book. So there were questions I had that I was able to get answered. And that was good. I don't know if I would have had that question answered if I had not done this.
And maybe 20 years ago, you wouldn't have recognized or been drawn to him for some reason.
Now, yeah, it's BMW. Let's be clear, you had some really nice cars.
Yes. When a child is very young, say, like 2 months old, and then as they grow older, can remember an incident that may have happened. I'm just going to give an example, like the hurricane of 38 being carried by my mom across a field to a relative's house. Mm-hmm. And I later recalled to my mom the color of the bathroom she was wearing, and she said, oh, that's not possible here. Not possible. Can you speak to that?
No, but I'll try to answer it anyway. I think what happens with young children, and by young I mean from birth, say, till the age of 4 or 5, is that they have the ability to sense things beyond the here and now, and have very clear memory of these things. They may not remember where they were playing yesterday, but you remember the color of that rose. Some children will tell you about, you know, a conversation they may have had with God or whoever, you know, you call God is. What's important is that the parent and whoever the adult figure is, if they shut the child down, you know, if they say, oh, that's impossible, you know, or you're crazy, or don't talk about that anymore, the child will do that. You know, the child will shut that down to the greatest ability he or she has and continue through life. That didn't happen to me. Okay, that was not what happened to me. I was around people for whom, yeah, she can do this, you know, she can write, she can draw, she can do this. And that was, I guess, a blessing. Does that help answer?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So the response a child gets to, quote unquote, these crazy things is absolutely critical.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for sharing that with all of us. It's a very powerful story. But as you were doing it, I sort of got the sense that maybe you are an emissary.
Oh.
And then what you are doing, sorry,
but... Like, I don't have enough to do that.
That you are, in a sense, bringing this to the world. You are allowing other people to experience how this has been, and perhaps you are, in some sense, opening people up to other things that they may not have thought about. And I just stuff that was very powerful, what you were saying, how you were doing it. Have you ever thought of yourself as an insane?
Oh, no. Well, not me. But I do believe with all my heart, and I said that at the beginning of the book, and I might have said it in one of the open passages, that in our society at this time, that it is very important for us to start having, quote, intelligent conversations about impossible things. Mm-hmm. And by impossible things, I don't mean just being able to contact the other side, okay? Mm-hmm. Which, on the face of it, seems to be impossible to so many people. Well, there's a range of impossible things we have to talk about. You know, there's, you know, eradicating poverty is impossible, so we say. Eradicating racism is impossible, so we say. You know, going to outer space and meeting other intelligent life, that's impossible, so we say. But these things are becoming closer and closer to us. And for whatever reason, we're going to be forced to contend with it. And my preference is to do it in an intelligent way without killing each other. So maybe the mission, the other mission of this book, is to spread the word that it's time to have intelligent conversations about impossible things. So to that extent, yes.
So it's coming out at a very good time.
Let's hope so. Any other questions, comments?
Well, I want to comment on what Brandon said. You know, Janice, and I'll just talk a little bit about Janice and her housemates. Janice was a very good friend of my sister's from back in the 80s. Janice and I didn't know each other. Anyway, my sister passed, Janice and I got to know each other. But talking about Janice being an emissary, you know, it turned out through many different things. Janice moved up here and we...
That's in the book too. How
But, you know, Janice starts talking about these things that I had no experience with at all. And, you know, opened my mind to these things because my path in life, I knew that I was missing something, I was searching for something. And it turns out that there were things I needed to learn, and these were part of the things. So with her being, you know, sort of that door for me, it opened me up to understanding that there is a whole nother world, you know, just a moment away to all of us. And I think that, you know, more of us that become open to that, it will change what's going on here in the physical once we begin to understand what's going on in the non-physical, and that that's where we came from.
Well, let me add something. The ancient definition of physics was, or ancient definition is, to study the true nature of reality. And somewhere I read recently, I said recently, the past couple of years, someone said, you know, if anyone can, quote unquote, prove the existence of God, it's going to be a physicist. And sure enough, a good friend of mine is an astrophysicist who has spent many years studying extraordinary phenomena. And to listen to him give an explanation of it, it'll give you a headache. But it's also, I think, reassuring to many people who live in the Western world and who need the security of the factual reality of this realm. And maybe in our lifetime, maybe not, the two paths of spirit and the material world will merge. So there are efforts going on out there. What is this? I mean, all these people can't be crazy. So it must, something's up. How do we know? You know, how do we study this? Yes, sir.
Do you think that our generation, well, baby boom generation, are all aging? And as we age, I'm aging. My knees give up. consciousness, because as we, as our physical break, as our physical world starts to break down, mm-hmm. we're forced more into our spiritual world, our mm-hmm. real beings.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just, and I don't think any of this is crazy. Mm-hmm. Every time you go for communion, this thing happens in mm-hmm. one world, the physical world, and the spiritual world. Mm-hmm. This relationship stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just wondering, though, if there's so many of us aging, do you think there'll be a swell? We're losing people in the churches, people aren't going on church anymore,
mm-hmm.
But more people are feeling spiritual.
I mean, I tend to think as we get towards what we think might be the end of life, we start thinking about, is this it? This is all there is? You know, and whether you want to or not, you find yourself wondering more and more, well, you're going to die, and then what? So, yes, I think, like, looking inward or examining, you know, your spiritual beliefs or the lack thereof, it is a natural progression of life. I think those people who are able to do it on the front end have a distinct reason for doing it, whether they, you know, are born with somebody's characteristics like mine. I mean, I was always been interested in God. That was like one of the first conversations I ever had with my grandfather was, what is God and where is God? But, you know, this experience of living on earth, there are a lot of lessons that we have to learn, and I think a lot of them are unique to the age we are, you know. I mean, look, the life most of us led in our 20s is certainly not the life most of us are leaving, living in our 50s or 60s. Whatever that may be. But, you know, it's a different chapter of your life. And I just really wonder about those people who don't question those things. And, you know, really think, well, you know, this is it. I die. And I know some of them. And I have no clue as to how they get through life. I have no clue as to how they get through tragedy. I don't understand. I don't understand. So the short answer, yeah. You know, you get towards the end and you start, well, what is out there? And today we have so many books, you know, about the nature of consciousness. I mean, whether it's Kevin Alexander and, you know, Proof of Heaven, the rising popularity of so many legitimate mediums and psychics. I mean, you know, yeah, there are whacks out there who pretend to, you know, be psychics and hang up their shingle and rob you of your money, but for every one of them, you know, there are two or three legitimate ones.
Well, I guess what I was leading to is,
yeah.
You know, just like this, people are stepping up now, just like you are stepping up and sharing the story.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of an interest, but different story.
Mm-hmm.
Women are stepping up and saying no more sexual harassment.
Yeah.
And there really is a tipping point where that really is changing our culture, hopefully.
Yeah.
And I'm just thinking, maybe you are the vanguard of people stepping up. I know another woman who wrote a book about communicating with her father after that.
Mm-hmm.
And becoming so that we all become more aware.
Yeah, I think it's time. I think it's time. I think it's important to understand that we as a species have not finished evolving. This is not it. Thank God. This is not it. You know, we got a ways to go, you know, to become more intelligent, more sensitive, more whatever, more just.
More loving.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe this is what is beginning in a fairly radical way in this country, but it's happening.
I'd like to speak about getting through tragedy. On Veterans Day last year, my husband passed over in the Memorial Hospital here in North Conway. And he was in the intensive care unit. A time when I went home and put on the wall switch, which turns on the light in the bay window, and it also turns on my very favorite lamp, which has carved balls swimming around on this beautiful ceramic base. And the bay window light went on, but my favorite lamp did not go on. So I changed the bulbs, and that didn't work. And I changed the outlet, and that didn't work. And I went to the hospital, and when I saw Sully, I said, "Oh, my favorite lamp won't come on." And he said, "Go home, Rocky, and get the WD-40 and spray in there. Make contact. It'll work." So I went home, and I did just what he said, and it didn't work. So I went back, and it doesn't work. He said, "Don't worry, Rocky. When I come home, I'll fix it." But he didn't come home from the hospital. And I couldn't overnight at the house, and so I stayed with some friends that have a B&B on the West Side Road for 2 months overnight. But I would go home and take a nap on his side of the bed every day. About the third day, when I woke up from a nap, I said, "I think I'll try it one more time." And I flipped the switch and I came on. And then also, a visionary had said to me, "He's going to present in the form of a bear with a heart and an eagle." We have eagles nesting above our house in Alaska, and we see a lot of bear in our yard. So, unbeknownst to me, and unbeknownst to this really dear friend in Alaska, I got a mail about 10 days after Sally passed, this lovely pin, a copper pin. I wear a t-shirt, and it's a bear with a heart. And he had no idea. And then when I was staying at this B&B, about maybe 8 or 9 days after someone passed, I got up one morning and I went out in the kitchen where they always had coffee, and we'd watch the birds and the horses, and it's a marvelous place. They're wonderful people. And one of the horse girls said to me, "Well, you missed it, Rock." And I said, "What?" And she said, "Of all the eagle came in and made 8 passes in the yard right by the window and then flew off. And as it happens, it is by number." So I just said, And we carry on conversations regularly. Just today on my way home from Littleton, he had something rather profound to say.
And it happens,
And the neat thing is while my mother said it's impossible, she didn't shut me down, I just put it away.
Good for you. One more question, and then we can meet and greet and do whatever. Sip cookies, whatever.
Janice, you said you're a private person, so how is it for you to tell the story and then to read it and sort of open yourself up to the questions and the curiosity, as well as recognizing that some people are going to come across skepticism and some people? But how is that for you?
I'm peculiarly calm about it. I guess the thing I think most about are the skeptics, the ones who just want to come in and crash it all. And for those people, they need to leave. I'm not on a mission to quote unquote convert people. Okay, that's not my intent. My intent with this is, at the very least, to inspire or provoke people to do their own research. Okay, that's it. So to the skeptics who want to come in and denounce it, that's fine. But my response to them is, you need to leave. Why stay here? I don't know what else to go home.
And for you, and for that opening up of your story in general, how is that?
It's peculiar. It's very peculiar. Look, for a while, my mother didn't even have my phone number, so there were reasons, but it's sort of surreal
you know, almost like having an out-of-body experience, you know, just sort of standing there eating and thinking, who is that? Crazy? But it is something I deeply believe has to be done. And I genuinely, I don't know all the reasons why, but it has to be done. So to the extent that I can do it, I will do it. And when it's time to stop, I will stop.
And you mentioned that you do have resources in the back of the book.
Yes.
Very, I would encourage everyone to, I mean, there really is a lot of information out now about this subject. It is fortunately being talked about more, mainstream media, lots of different places. I'm always amazed at all the different, well, jump on a website and I'll find like two more books to read. It's just, it is becoming, because people are looking for this. They're thinking this can't be right. There's got to be more.
Well, and it's books that are written by highly credible people.
Yeah.
You know, not Boo-Boo the Fool sitting in a tent somewhere, but lawyers and private detectives and psychologists and neurosurgeons. And, so you read one book and you go, well, you know, be a bad scholar. but you read two, three, four, and you begin to see the similarity of conclusions. You can draw connections, you begin to see, okay, so all of these people can't be crazy. That's the bottom line. All these people can't be crazy. There's something going on. Mm-hmm. And why not find out? I mean, I don't like stupid people, so I particularly want everybody to read as much as they can about everything, because it's out there. Information is out there if you want it. If you don't want it, that's fine. If you want it, if you're sincere about trying to explore this and find out, what is this? It's there. So.
And I'll just say one more thing. Because on the back of two people, two endorsements. One is Rudy Shield, who is the astrophysicist that's a friend of Janice's that she was mentioning. But the other person talking about is Suzanne Geisman. Has anyone ever heard of Suzanne Geisman? She is a naval officer. And this is what's so interesting about what's going on now, are these people that, you know, are from lawyers and psychologists and all this kind of, she was a naval officer. She was the aide to the Joint Chiefs of Staff.
That's right.
She was really high up, left brain, black and white, never did anything with any of this. Never even crossed her mind. She was a naval officer, and her life changed in a moment when her stepdaughter was killed.
Struck by lightning.
And Suzanne is somebody who is, that's another fascinating story. You know, she wasn't born with it like Janice was. She came into it later in life because, sort of I look at it, that she was chosen to get the message out. And she writes an excerpt endorsing Janice's book. And Suzanne has been categorized as one of the best psychics.
Best out there. Evidential medium.
Best evidential medium, yes.
Actually went to United Kingdom for training. There is a school. And she jumped right in. Yeah, you know, the woman, Navy, I mean, she was one of the last people to fly over the World Trade Center the day it was bombed. She was flying over with her boss, and they were the only plane in the sky till they landed. So, yeah, it's like, really? Listen, thank you very much.
You
can sit here and talk all night.
But go back home.
Yes. Draw that book. I have stuff to do.
Books to write.
Books to write. Places to go.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.